Good evening to all of you. Welcome to the third lecture of this course. Today's lecture will be on basic concept of polarimetric SAR remote sensing. Now, in this lecture, we are going to explore the potential of polarimetric SAR remote sensing. Before exploring the potential of polarimetric SAR, we will discuss the requirement of polarimetric data set. And here in the front slide, you can see this is the polarimetric decomposition based false color composite image of RISAT-1 data. So RISAT-1 had provided the quad pole data, and this is the data over Mumbai area. So false color composite image was generated by extracting the scattering information. So here blue color is given to the surface scattering, green color is given to the volume scattering, and red color is given to the double bounce scattering. Now after that, the false color composite image has been generated, and here we can see that since sea surface is behaving like a smooth surface, so there is dominance of surface scattering, and urban area is having double bounce scattering as well the multiple reflection due to the vegetation, so that we are going to get mixed responses from the urban area. Somewhere we are getting the dominance of volume scattering, and somewhere we are going to get the dominance of the double bounce scattering. And the patches where we are going to get different other colors like white color. So white color means all the scattering components are very high. In surface scattering, double bounce scattering, volume scattering, all the scatterings are very high for those locations, so that those particular patches are appearing as a bright color. And if you are able to see any area or location in or any feature in yellow color, it means that there is dominance of double bounce scattering and volume scattering. Now we are going to start our lecture by knowing the complex SAR image. SAR data set is always represented by complex number. Each and every resolution cell is the smallest unit of any image acquired by the sensor, and pixel will be the smallest unit of the digital image. So each and every resolution cell will be represented by complex numbers to provide the phase and amplitude information. Because if the data set will not be there in the complex format, so it will be difficult to do the polarimetry and the interferometry. So this is the first requirement. The data set should always be there in the complex format. This is the radar set 2 C-band data set for Dhoon Valley. So here in the image, we can easily see the undulating terrain, the hilly terrain. This could be easily seen in the image. And since the SAR data set will not, SAR data sets are not sensitive to the color information, so that they are represented at the gray level, false color composite images could be generated. But here, the information is represented at grayscale level. The location where we are getting the bright patches, it means that we are going to get very high scattering from those location. And the area where we are getting dark patches, so these are showing that there is less scattering. Less scattering means the very less amount is going back towards the sensor, so that sensor is not able to receive any information, so that these locations or these areas are identified as dark patches in the SAR image, like water body. This is the river Ganga. So for water, we can easily see here, water is appearing a very, very dark linear feature. Now, one may think, like in the previous image, we have seen that there was one polarization, the image generated under one polarimetric combination of radar set 2. So one may think that what is the requirement of the quad pole data? Because if we will have the scattering information from single polarization or the dual polarimetric SAR data set, then what is the requirement and need of the quad pole data? Actually, if you will see in the previous image, so for each and every resolution cell, there will be one unique value, and that unique value will be represented by the complex number. And if you convert into the intensity or amplitude, there will be one intensity value or the amplitude value. It means that for the entire resolution cell, like in this case, the resolution is approximately after doing the processing to minimize the slant to ground range ambiguity, and after doing the multi-looking, the pixel size or resolution cell size is now 8 to 10 meter for this data set. Now, in 8 to 10 meter resolution cell, there will be only one backscatter value. And similarly, like for different locations, for each and every 10 meter resolution cell, we will have only one backscatter value. Now, just see this image. Suppose there is homogeneity in the feature. Suppose there is only grassland or there is only water body. If there is only one kind of feature or only one type of class, then there is no problem. Scattering information could be retrieved from single polarized SAR data set. But if there is increase in heterogeneity within resolution cell, then there is a requirement of other polarimetric combinations of the SAR data set to retrieve the information. Like here, in this case, we can see this is the main building of IRS. So if you will see the main building of IRS, so the vertical walls of the building will be contributing in double bounce scattering. And if you will see this smooth surface, the road in front of the building, this road is going to contribute in the surface scattering because this is perfectly smooth surface. And this vegetation cover is going to contribute in the volume scattering. Why? Because when the electromagnetic waves or the SAR waves will be interacting with the this vegetation or trees, so first interaction of the electromagnetic wave will be there with the tree leaves. And when the electromagnetic waves will get the canopy gap, or if they will be able to penetrate the canopy cover, then the second interaction will be there from the small twigs. After that, the electromagnetic waves will be interacting with the branches, and then they will be interacting with the stem of the tree. Now in the return signal, since there is multiple scattering from different component of the structure, so the entire volume of the tree or the vegetation will be contributing in the scattering, so that this scattering is known as volume scattering, because entire volume of the tree or the forest structure or the vegetation is contributing in the scattering, so that this is the volume scattering. So now main problem will occur when the entire feature or all the features will be coming within single resolution cell. Suppose the data set will have, suppose the SAR sensor will have the capability to acquire the SAR data with a spatial resolution of 20 meter. So in the 20 meter resolution, what will happen? There will be only one scattering value in one polarimetric channel, and that scattering of one polarimetric channel within resolution cell will be contributed by this building, this road, and this vegetation. And it is really difficult to extract the scattering information contributed by different features within a resolution cell with the help of single polarized or dual polarized data set. If we will have the quad pole data set, then by implementing the concept of interaction of electromagnetic wave with different type of features, one will be able to retrieve different scattering information contributed by different type of features within the resolution cell. It means that if one will be interested to retrieve how much information or how much scattering contribution is there due to this building, so that information could be retrieved when we will have the fully polarimetric SAR data. And when if anyone will be interested to retrieve the scattering contributed by the surface scatter or smooth surfaces, that scattering component could also be retrieved, and the vegetation scattering could also be retrieved. Now, one may think, what is the need to retrieve the different scattering components within the resolution cell? Actually, when the people are doing modeling approaches to retrieve forest parameter like forest stem volume or above ground biomass, or if people are interested to do the modeling approaches to estimate soil moisture, or if they are interested to do the modeling approaches to retrieve the information of snow wetness and the information retrieval, a scattering component retrieval due to the different type of snow according to their wetness. So at that time, and for several other agricultural applications also, at that time people are really interested to know how much scattering is contributed by different type of features, because each and every feature will be behaving like a different type of scatterer according to their shape, size, and dielectric property. Like here, in this case, mainly when there is heterogeneity in the resolution cell due to different type of features like this building, road, and vegetation, so the structure of the objects or features are going to play major role in the scattering contribution. Now, to retrieve the scattering contribution due to the different features, we are in need to use fully polarimetric or quad pole data set. Now, when we are talking about the polarimetric data or fully polarimetric SAR data set, it means that we are going to use all the possible polarimetric combinations of the SAR data set. Like in this case, we have maximum four polarimetric combinations, HH, HB, VH, and VV, where HH is representing the transmission of horizontally polarized light, horizontally polarized electromagnetic wave or SAR wave, and another HH representing the receiving of the horizontally polarized electromagnetic wave. So the combination is HH, means horizontally polarized electromagnetic waves were transmitted and horizontally polarized were received. Similarly, in the case of HV, horizontally polarized electromagnetic waves were transmitted and vertically polarized electromagnetic waves were received. Like here we can see, the polarization is defined, as we know that polarization is defined according to the vibration of electric field vector in the frame of reference of the propagation axis. Each and every polarimetric combination or polarimetric channel is going to provide a complex image. So now, with the help of one polarimetric combination, we will have only one image. If we are going to use all the four polarimetric combinations in the SAR data set or in the SAR system, so we will have four complex images. Now, with the help of four complex images, it will become very easy to implement the modeling approaches to retrieve different type of scattering element from a small area or single resolution cell. First, we are going to see the Stokes vector format of the data set. Now, Stokes vector form of the data set will have the four Stokes vector, S0, S1, S2, and S3. Now, Stokes vector are the power representation of the SAR data set. And with the help of this power representation of the SAR data set, it is possible to do the decomposition modeling, because currently we cannot do the decomposition modeling with the help of intensity image or intensity or amplitude data set of the polarimetric channels like HH, HB, VH, and VB. For to do the decomposition modeling, it is always required that the polarimetric channels of the SAR data set should be represented by complex numbers. Now, in the Stokes vector format, the data set will be represented by the power representation of the SAR data set, and there is one criteria to evaluate the performance of the system to generate fully polarimetric or the quad pole data set. For a fully polarimetric SAR data set, the condition is the square of the first Stokes vector should be equal to the sum of squares of remaining elements, remaining three elements. So here we can see that S0 square is equal to S1 square plus S2 square plus S3 square. Now, when we will have the horizontal and the vertical polarimetric channels, so one can easily retrieve the Stokes parameters from the quad pole data set, and when we will have the information of the Stokes parameter, so with the help of Stokes parameter, one can easily find out the other property of the SAR data, like the orientation and the ellipticity. So orientation of the ellipticity of the SAR data set could also be retrieved when the Stokes parameter are known. Like here we can see when we will have the four Stokes parameter. So the if S0 is the first Stokes parameter, so the remaining Stokes parameters or the elements could be retrieved or could be represented in the terms of the first Stokes vector. Here one can see S1 will be equal to S0 cos 2 psi and cos 2 chi. So here one can easily see that the remaining Stokes parameter could be easily represented in the terms of S0, ellipticity, and the orientation angle. Now, when the Stokes parameter are generated, so this is the data set, quad pole data set of Dhoon Valley, and the data set was acquired by the radar set 2 C-band. Now here we can see the S, the representation of different Stokes vector and Stokes parameter. So here you can see this is the first Stokes parameter, and since the first Stokes parameter will have the maximum value or the maximum power, so that you can see features could be easily identified, different features could be easily identified in this image. And here the values are ranging from 0.0 to 0.63. Now in first Stokes vector, relatively we are going to get less power in comparison to the first Stokes vector, so that here range of the values is also less, minus 0.01 to 0.5. And here you can see the representation of the features are not very much clear in comparison to the first image. And similarly, there will be decrease in the power when we will moving from first parameter to the second, third, and the fourth parameters. Now, scattering matrix, this is the most famous representation of the quad pole data set, because there are very few satellites for which the data set is provided in the Stokes matrix format or Stokes parameters format. Now, most of the data sets are provided in scattering matrix format. Quad pole data sets are provided in scattering matrix format. Now, scattering matrix is a 2x2 matrix which is generated with the help of all the four polarimetric combinations like HH, HV, VH, and VV. Users are free to select SVV as first or SHH as first, where SH is representing the polarimetric combination of the image in which horizontally polarized electromagnetic waves were transmitted and the horizontally polarized electromagnetic waves were received. And VV is representing transmission of vertical polarimetric vertical polarization of the electromagnetic field, and at the time of receiving, vertically polarized electromagnetic waves were received. Similarly, HV and VH. Now, if you will see this scattering matrix, the diagonal elements both are having the same polarization which were used in the transmission and receiving. Like in the first case, it is HH, and in the second, or you can say the second diagonal element, we can see it is SVV. So these two channels, HH and VV, these are known as like polarization, because the similar type of information which was transmitted was received at the time of receiving. So that this is known as like polarization, because horizontally polarized was transmitted and the similar information was received at the time of receiving the scattered signal. So that the combination is HH and VV, and the name is given like polarization. And if you'll see the off diagonal elements of this scattering matrix, so off diagonal elements are having the opposite polarization. HV and VH means horizontally polarized electromagnetic wave was transmitted and just opposite was received, so that the combination is HV, and similarly in the case of VH. So these polarimetric combinations are known as cross polarizations. Now, this is the quad pole representation of the SAR data set. So first you can see, this is the first polarimeter image generated from the first polarimetric combination HH, and this is the HV, HH and VV. These are the like polarizations, because same polarimetric, same polarization was used at the time of transmission and receiving the electromagnetic pulses. So these are the like polarization. Now, if you will see the each and every feature, they will have different type of scattering behavior. Even the data set is C-band only, and the angle of incidence is also fixed for this data set, but each and every feature will behave differently in different polarimetric combination, so that their scattering contribution will be different in different polarimetric combinations. Here one can see, like in the case of HH, one can easily see, like this is the barcode forest range of the Dune Valley, this is Thano forest range of the Dune Valley, and this is undulating terrain. And dark strip, the black dark strip, this is basically the Dehradun airport. Now, the urban structure, which is clearly visible in HH polarization, is not clearly visible in the remaining polarimetric combination. Similarly, if you will see this vegetation information has more enhancement in comparison to actually, like, since these are the relative values, so here this is also appearing bright, and here it is also appearing bright. But if you will compare with the other features, so this vegetation is appearing bright in comparison to the other features. So that we are using different polarimetric combinations, and we are going to do the modeling. Now, in the decomposition modeling, what we are going to do, we are going to break the scattering matrix to retrieve our desired scattering element. Now, in this process, what we are going to do, we are going to generate first order derivative of scattering matrix element. So to generate first order derivative of scattering matrix element, there are two processes. One is the generation of the first order derivative with the help of lexicographic feature vector. Another is poly feature vector. Now, after that, we will generate the second order derivative. And finally, we will use the second order derivative elements for the decomposition modeling to retrieve a scattering element. So first we are going to see the first feature vector. This is the lexicographic feature vector. And you can see the elements of lexicographic feature vectors are 100, 0100, then 001, and 0010. Now, what is the meaning? When you will implement these lexicographic feature vectors on the SAR data set, then you are going to get the another matrix that will be a 4x1 matrix. So here in this case, what we are going to get, when you will implement this feature vector on the quad pole data set, then what will happen, the remaining three elements like HV, VV and VH will become zero, only HH will be available. Similarly, when the second will be implemented, only one HV will be there, then VH, and similarly VV. Now, when we will combine all the feature vectors, so we are going to get one element that will be 4x1 matrix. Now, another feature vector is poly feature vector. This is basically defined on the concept of on the theory of the poly spin of particles, as it was defined in quantum mechanics and particle physics. But the same concept is used here to derive the scattering mechanism and the scattering element. So here what we are going to get, if you will see here, the first poly feature vector is 10 and 10. It means that all the two diagonal elements will be there, and off diagonal elements will become zero. And this 1 and 1 is representing the same sign of the scattering. It means that whatever the phase of electromagnetic wave was there at the time of transmission, the same phase was there when the electromagnetic wave was scattered or reflected. Generally, perfect one condition we are going to get when there is perfect specular reflection. Now, this is the second element, 10 minus 10. Now, in this case, again, both the diagonal elements are present. Off diagonal elements are zero. Now, in this case, what is happening? This is representing that the electromagnetic wave which was transmitted and just opposite with similar intensity or same intensity was received with opposite phase. Generally, this is the condition occurring in your urban structure due to vertical walls. Suppose there is vertical wall, so what will happen? SAR sensor will transmit electromagnetic pulses, and if there is any smooth surface, there will be one bounce from the smooth surface, and if there is any urban structure having vertical wall, so the entire information will be reflected towards the urban structure, and due to the wall of the urban structure, entire amount will be again reflected towards the direction of the sensor. It means that the direction, suppose the forward direction is positive direction, so the entire amount which is returning in the backward direction towards the sensor will be the negative direction, so that the negative sign is used, 1 and minus 1. Means here the scattering will be very high, but with opposite phase. So generally, when we are going to get, going to take this combination, it means that we are going to enhance the double bounce scattering information. When we are going to use the first element, then we are going to enhance the surface scattering information or odd bounce scattering information. Now the remaining two elements when we are going to see, so here we are having zero diagonal elements and off diagonal elements are one. It means that we are going to enhance the scattering in the cross polarimetric channel. Scattering in cross polarimetric channel, so cross polarimetric channels are representing the transmission of one polarization and the receiving of just opposite polarization. So this type of change, complete change of polarization, is generally occurring from multiple reflection from volume scattering, so that this combination is going to enhance the vegetation information. Similarly, this third and fourth both are going to enhance the vegetation information. Now when we are going to take when we are going to implement on the scattering element, so what will happen when we will implement the first poly feature vector on the scattering matrix, then we will have HH plus VV. When we are going to implement this second element, then we will have HH minus VV or VV minus HH. Intensity will be finally same. And when we are going to implement the third one, it will be HV plus VH. And in the case of fourth, it will be HV minus VH. The imaginary quantity J will be just out of the bracket because J is already there. And here it is used transpose just to say that here matrix will be 4 by 1 matrix. Now, scattering matrix could be represented in the terms of the poly basis, where F0, F1, F2, and F3 are representing the four poly feature vector or the poly basis. With the help of that, one can easily represent the scattering matrix in the terms of poly feature vectors or the poly basis also. Now what will happen? That is the first order derivative. Previously we have seen the lexicographic and the poly feature vectors. These are known as the first order derivative of the scattering matrix. Now we are going to decompose the scattering matrix by taking the second order derivative of the scattering matrix. Now second order derivative of the scattering matrix will be the first order derivative of the lexicographic or poly feature vector. Now when we are going to use the lexicographic feature vector, so with the help of lexicographic feature vector, covariance matrix will be generated, and with the help of poly feature vector, coherence matrix will be generated. So now we are going to see the two matrices, covariance matrix and the coherency matrix. Now the covariance matrix is generated when the lexicographic feature vector is multiplied by its own transconjugate. So here this lexicographic feature vector is having the matrix represented by 4 by 1. When you are going to take the transpose of the 4 by 1 matrix, it will become 1 by 4. And in 1/4, again, you will have to take the complex conjugate, because these values HH, SV, VH, and VV, these all are represented in complex number in A plus IB format, where A is the real component and B is the imaginary component of the SAR data set. Okay, so here we are going to take the not only the transpose of the lexicographic feature vector, we are going to take the complex conjugate of the combinations of the lexicographic feature vectors, like complex conjugate of HH, then HV, then VH, and VV. Okay, so when this will be multiplied, so finally we will have multiplication of 4/1 and 1/4 matrix, so that finally we will have 4/4 matrix. And the elements of this 4/4 matrix will be your real values, because off diagonal elements will be represented by again the complex numbers, but the diagonal elements will have the real values only. Now here we are going to consider the two symmetries, reflection symmetry and the rotational symmetry. So mainly we are going to talk about the reflection symmetry, in which it has been assumed that the assumption which we are going to use, there are several assumptions under the reflection symmetry, but the main assumption which we are going to use is the information acquired by the monostatic SAR system will have the similar value in off diagonal elements or similar value in your cross polarimetric channel. Either you can say similar value of off diagonal elements of a scattering matrix, or the similar value of the cross polarimetric channels. In that case, HV will become VH. When HV will become VH, it means that there is no use to use both the polarimetric channels HV and VH. One can take the sum of HV and VH. So finally, in place of 4/4 matrix, your value will be reduced to 3/3. Earlier, you had 16 values in the covariance matrix. Now you will have 9 values only. Like here in this case, one can see the monostatic reciprocal backscattering case by taking the assumption of the reciprocity, HB will be equals to VH in the monostatic sensor. And this is also one parameter to judge the quality of the polarimetric SAR data set. If the sensor is fully polarimetric, or if the sensor is providing fully polarimetric SAR data set, it means that HV should be equal to VH. If HV is not exactly equal to VH, it means that there is requirement to calibrate the data set, or there is requirement to calibrate the sensor, because this is the assumption which is used for the monostatic sensor. HV should always be equal to VH. Now here you can see HH, then square root 2 HV and VV. Now again, when the transconjugate will be taken of this 3/1 matrix, so what will happen when it will multiply it with its own transconjugate? So finally we will have 1 3/3 matrix. Now another feature vector is the poly feature vector or the poly matrix. Here we can see there are the combinations HH plus VV, HH minus VV, and HV. Because the fourth element, if you can see the fourth element, this will become zero, HV minus VH, because in the case of monostatic SAR system, if both will become same, so there is no use to use this fourth element, because this will become zero. So under the reciprocity assumption, this 3/1 matrix was generated, HH plus VV, HH minus VV, and HV. And since we have seen that during explanation, like HH plus VV is very much sensitive for the surface scattering, HH minus VV is very much sensitive for the double bounce scattering, because the intensity is same, but just opposite was transmitted or reflected towards the sensor. And here HV is sensitive to the volume scattering. So one color composite image was generated with the help of these three elements. When HH plus VV was represented by a blue color, HH minus VV was represented by a red color, and HV was represented by green color. So in this color composite, what we are able to see, entire sea surface is represented or showing the dominance of surface scattering. And this vegetation cover of this hilly terrain or mountainous terrain is showing the vegetation cover is representing the dominance of the volume scattering. And the urban area, like the city area or the urban structure of the San Francisco city, is showing the double bounce scattering, dominance of the double bounce scattering. So here poly feature vector is also a good representation of the different type of scattering elements within resolution cell. Here in this case, each and every resolution, each and every pixel will have all these three values, like values of HH plus VV, values of HH minus VV, and HV. But since here, the remaining two values, like values of HH minus VV and HV, are very less in the sea surface, and this value is having highest value, so that this is represented in blue color. Each and every resolution cell will have all these three values, and the image will be generated according to their color combination, which is used according to their values, or the dominance of the scattering in the particular area or particular feature. Now, this is the first step, as we have talked, that when we will have the SLC data set, then there is a requirement to minimize the slant range ambiguity of the SAR data set. When the slant range ambiguity will be minimized, so due to two different resolutions, like azimuth resolution and range resolution, the shape of the resolution cell will become rectangular, and generally it is preferred to work with square pixel shape. So now, after doing slant to ground range ambiguity, there will not be any compression or any distortion in azimuth direction. Distortion will be there, or compression will be there only in range direction. So slant to ground range conversion will be mainly effective in the range direction. So this is the formula to convert the slant to ground range, like pixel space in range direction divided by sine of angle of incidence or look angle, will convert the data set from slant to ground range. Now here one example is given. If the pixel spacing in azimuth direction is 6 meter and pixel spacing in range direction is 4 meter and look angle is 30 degree, then in that case pixel spacing in ground range or ground range will be equal to 4 divided by sine of angle of incidence. This will become 8 meter. Now what we are going to get, the azimuth resolution is 6 meter and the ground range resolution is 8 meter. So again, shape of the pixel will become rectangular, and generally, as we know, that it is preferred to work with the square pixel shape. So to generate the square pixel shape, this there is requirement to take contribution of 4 pixels in azimuth direction and contribution of 3 pixels in range direction to create a bigger pixel or bigger resolution of 24 meter by 24 meter. Okay, so here what we are going to see, this is the radar set 2 data. Earlier in the previous case, we had generated an image by different number of looks. Now here, the values were generated according to the by default values provided by the software, because one can either select the number of looks according to the calculation, or one nowadays softwares are capable to easily detect the optimum number of looks. So this is the optimum number of looks selected by the software. So as we have already seen, there is a decrease in the spatial resolution during the multi-looking. So here there is decrease in the spatial resolution when we will zoom it, but there is enhancement in the radiometric property, so that we can see that it is very easy to identify the different type of features in the imagery after the multi-looking approach. Slant to ground range ambiguity minimization and the multi-looking approach. Now, when the fully polarimetric SAR data set will be multi-looked, so now it will become the multi-look complex data set, so that there are different modeling approaches to retrieve the scattering element. So there are two main decomposition techniques, coherent decomposition and incoherent decomposition. So in coherent decomposition, we have already seen the example, poly decomposition or Sinclair decomposition or the lexicographic decomposition. These are known as the coherent decomposition. And the incoherent decomposition or model-based decomposition, there are more than, I think, more than 50 models. And even if you go in the software, 20 to 25 models you are going to get in the software itself. Okay, because each and every year, people are developing their modeling approaches to show the quality of the scattering retrieval. So another modeling approaches are known as the incoherent decomposition. These are the model-based decomposition technique. So Freeman and Darden, they were the first people to develop the decomposition modeling approaches. So Freeman Darden decomposition was first published in 1998. And this is a three-component decomposition model. Now one more component was added by Dr. Yamaguchi. So Yamaguchi decomposition was there. Now after that, there are several modeling approaches. By doing some enhancement, either in the conventional modeling approaches or by the new approaches. There are one more approach based on the eigenvalue and the eigenvector-based decomposition, but we are mainly restricting ourselves in model-based decomposition. Okay. So why this is known as the coherent decomposition, poly feature vector is known as the coherent decomposition, and coherency matrix-based modeling approach is known as the incoherent decomposition. Why? Because here, only if you will see the poly feature vector or poly basis, there will be only one type of scattering elements used to derive one scattering element. Like in the case of surface scattering, which is retrieved through HH plus VV. So what we are getting, we have used only like polarimetric channels. In the case of double bounce scattering, what we did, again, we used the like polarimetric channels. In the case of volume scattering, we retrieved only this one, a cross-polarimetric channel. But when there will be, again, the problem will be when there will be increase, very much increase in the heterogeneity, when the heterogeneity will be very high. So there is requirement to use other features, there is requirement to use the combination of this scattering element. Suppose this HH plus VV is going to provide the very good information of the surface scattering. Suppose any surface scatterer within a resolution cell is mixed with a vegetation or tree. So at that time, one will be required to use the combination of both to retrieve the exact information of scattering within the resolution cell. Otherwise, for one resolution, we are going to get only one value, and similarly, since we are using different element, we can get, but that value will not be very much reliable. Okay, so that we are going to use the combination. Like if you will see the coherency matrix element, so in when you will see the coherency matrix element, the element number T13 is a combination of HH plus VB multiplied by complex conjugate of HV. It means that if this element will be used in the modeling, so that modeling output will be very much sensitive for those locations where surface scattering is mixed with the vegetation or smooth surface is mixed with the vegetation. Similarly, if you will see the element number S12, so this will be very much sensitive for those areas where surface scatter is mixed with the double bounce scatters. So both features could be easily retrieved. So use of these elements in the modeling approaches will give the reliable results. Here, in this case, the diagonal elements will be showing the intensity or the power representation of the value. Off-diagonal elements will be the complex number. But like if you will see the off-diagonal elements like S12, that will be equal to the S21 when you will take the modulus. Okay, this is the property due to the Hermitian nature of the coherency matrix. Okay, when you will zoom the false color composite of the multi-looked poly decomposition, so here we are able to see in the 10 meter resolution, finally this is a 10 meter resolution, 9 to 10 meter resolution. In this resolution also one is able to see the towers of the Golden Gate Bridge and urban area and the vegetation scattering, all are enhanced here. Now, when the second order derivative will be generated, so T11, T22, T33, and the other elements. So here what we are going to get, T11 is very much sensitive for the surface scattering. So like here for the smooth surfaces, for the sea surface, T11 is having very high scattering. And similarly, T22 is sensitive for the double bounce scattering. So very high scattering is obtained from urban area. And T33 will be sensitive for the volume scattering. So volume scattering is not only received from the vegetation, but also from the other location, from the urban area and the other features, so that we are getting these combinations. And finally, this is the sum of T11, T22, T33, so that this is the span of the matrix. Now, with the help of these matrices, this coherency matrix, elements of the coherency matrix, we are going to retrieve the scattering information. So mainly, we are going to think about these three scattering: surface scattering, double bounce scattering, volume scattering. Surface scattering, which will be contributed by the perfectly or nearly perfect or smooth surfaces. Okay. Double bounce scattering will be contributed by the two bounces. First bounce will be there from the smooth surface, and the second bounce will be there if there is any vertical structure near to the smooth surface, like in the case of forest structure, the stem of the tree and the a ground stem interaction of the electromagnetic wave will give the double bounce scattering, and the volume scattering will be obtained from the small branches, big branches, twigs, and the leaves of the tree. Now, this is the Freeman decomposition model, which is used to retrieve the three scattering elements. So when the surface scattering, double bounce, and volume scattering components, these were implemented on the coherency matrix. So we received the different scattering elements like surface scattering, double bounce scattering. Now, if you compare the surface scattering and the, because T11, the first coherency, first element of the coherency matrix, is also sensitive for the surface scattering. But if you compare the surface scattering retrieved from this decomposition model and the surface scattering of T11, so very high enhancement we are going to get here in this case. Okay, like here, Bragg's law of this derivation was derived on the concept of the Bragg's law of X-ray scattering. The second was derived on the concept of Fresnel's law of double bounce scattering. The third, volume scattering, was derived. Actually, these elements 1/4 and the remaining elements are coming due to the probability distribution function, PDF function, and main concept was used of the interaction of electromagnetic wave with randomly oriented dipoles, so that we are going to get different scattering. Like here, all the double bounce scatters are enhanced here. Now, when the color composite was generated, we are going to get the color composite for the study area. Now, another modeling approach was developed by Dr. Yamaguchi, and this is known as the Yamaguchi decomposition, four component decomposition model. And all the model based decomposition models were mainly derived by doing some modification in Freeman or Yamaguchi decomposition only, except eigenvalues and the eigenvector based modeling approaches. All the modeling approaches which are present, if you will see in the list, there are 20-25 modeling approaches. So they are mainly derived from the components of the Freeman concept or concept given by the Freeman and Yamaguchi. Like here, if you will see the Yamaguchi decomposition model, so first two elements, if you will compare the first two elements, so these are exactly similar to the Freeman decomposition. Okay? But there is some enhancement, like Yamaguchi modeling approaches were again modified. Okay, so now in place of one, there are three different probability distribution functions were used in the volume scattering component retrieval. Okay, and this is the element used to retrieve the helix scattering. When these condition-based matrices were implemented on the coherency matrix, so we got like enhanced representation of the volume scattering in comparison to the Freeman decomposition model. Now here you can see This is the helix scattering element retrieved from the SAR dataset for the study area. But here the intensity value is really very, very low. And this is the color composite image generated from the surface dull bounce and volume scattering of the Yamaguchi decomposition model. Okay, and this is the ALOS pulsar dataset for Dun Valley. Again, you can see this is the barcode forest range, Thano forest range, and these are the dry river channels. So when the decomposition modeling was implemented, so here you can see that, like here, dry river channels are exactly identified as for L-band dataset, for ALOS pulsar dataset, they are appearing as smooth surfaces, and there is some kind of overestimation in scattering because the enhancement was done for the volume scattering element, particularly in the Yamaguchi decomposition model. So some enhancement we are getting, less volume scattering, particularly for this area, for forest area, in comparison to the Freeman decomposition model. Now, when the Yamaguchi decomposition model was implemented on the ALOS pulsar data set, ALOS 1 pulsar 1 data set for the Dun Valley, so for one location, this is the Bhel area of Haridwar. So here we are getting very high scattering in helix scattering component of the four component decomposition model. Now it is possible to do, because area is open to all the researchers, because the interaction of electromagnetic wave with different type of features, with different type of shape and sizes, are already given theoretically. One can take the concept and one can implement it in the SAR data set. Like here, one multiple component scattering model was developed by implementing the concept of interaction of electromagnetic wave with a wire kind of object. Okay, so that concept was developed. Similarly, like if you'll go even in the forest area, shape, size, structure of different type of trees will be different. So even one can model a single tree with long wavelength data set in different components. Suppose if you will see the teak tree. So teak tree, the tree leaf of the teak tree will be behaving like a kind of disc, because the size of the tree leaf of the teak tree will be approximately 25 to 30 centimeters. That will be behaving like a disc. And if you will see the tree leaf sizes of other shape and sizes of other trees, they will have sometimes the needle type of shape or some other structure. So one can do, one can implement the scattering component retrieval of those kind of features to get more reliable result. But those things are still not implemented. But in theories, interaction of electromagnetic wave with spherical type, cylindrical type, disc type, needle type is already derived. If one can go in detail, so they can develop, they can derive the higher order scattering elements. Like here in this case, multiple scattering element was derived by one scientist, and here in IRS, one student did her research by implementing the cosine squared distribution function. Cosine squared distribution function in the multiple component scattering model. Like if you will see the normal modeling approaches, so generally in the decomposition modeling, the normal distribution function is assumed. But here, like in the mathematics, if you go in detail, so if there is increase in heterogeneity, so cosine squared distribution function should be used. So cosine squared distribution function was used in the multiple scattering modeling approach. Now here you can see the enhancement in the result. Like this is the normal multiple result of the normal multiple component scattering, double bounce scattering element, and this is the result obtained from the cosine squared distribution function. There is no change in the helix scattering component, but in double bounce scattering and the wire scattering, we are going to get a lot of enhancement in the scattering information retrieval when you are going to change the distribution function. Okay, so one can think about the selection of distribution function according to the heterogeneity of the study area. Now, I am going to take 5 to 10 minutes on hybrid polarimetry. So hybrid polarimetry is basically the transmission of circular polarimetric electromagnetic wave and receiving of horizontal polarization. So here, since circular polarization was transmitted and horizontally polarized electromagnetic waves were received, so that this combination was known as hybrid polarimetric SAR system or hybrid polarimetric SAR architecture. So circularly polarized electromagnetic waves were transmitted by maintaining the 90 degree phase difference between horizontal and vertical component of the electric field vector. And at the time of receiving, as we know that polarization will be broken, and the system is going to receive all the type of polarization. It depends on the sensor orientation, what type of polarization it will be receiving in the receiving module. So like in this case, in this design, circular polarization was transmitted and horizontally was received. And this is the design for, I think, Chandrayaan 1 mini SAR, because finally the data set was converted in Stokes file format, and S1, S2, S3, S4 were the representation of those data sets. Now, when we are talking about the hybrid or compact polarimetric mode, so there are different modes, dual pole 1 and dual pole 2. In those modes, horizontal will be transmitted and horizontally and vertical will be received, so the combination will be HH and HV. In dual pole 2, vertical will be transmitted and horizontally and vertical will be received, so that combination will be VV and HV or VH. There is one mode by maintaining the phase difference of pi by 4. This is known as a CP1 mode. So here, CP mode with pi by 4 will be transmitted and horizontally and vertically will be received. So the two elements, CP1H and CP1V, will have these two values. The first element will be this combination of HH plus HV, and the second element will be combination of VV plus HV. Now, with the help of this dual pole data set, one can derive the quad pole property of the SAR data set with less onboard processing by covering a larger swath. And in CP2, phase difference will be maintained by pi by 2, so the circular polarization will be generated. So here, in this case, right circular was transmitted and horizontal and vertical was received. In the case of transmission of right circular polarization, so RH will be combination of HH minus, here I or J, sometimes I'm using, sometimes I, sometimes J. Basically, this is complex number, square root minus 1. So HH minus JHV, and the second element, RV, will be HV minus JVV. And again, we have already seen the, again, this is the similar thing when we will have the fully polarimetric SAR data. Now, this work was carried to show the potential or the quality of the hybrid pole before launch of RI set 1 data set. One researcher of IRS, Dr. Vishnu Nandan, he carried this research to show the potential of hybrid polarimetric nature of the SAR data set. So hybrid polarimetric data set was generated, but it was found that the scattering element, volume scattering element retrieved from compact polarimetry will always have less value in comparison to the fully polarimetric SAR data set. Because here in this graph, we see for most of the location, we are going to guess less compact polarimetric value in comparison to the fully polarimetric SAR value, SAR data value. But one advantage was there. Actually, tomorrow we will be discussing that problem. Due to the change in polarization orientation angle shift of the SAR data set, there is change in the scattering mechanism. Okay, so what we found that in the hybrid polarimetric SAR data set, since the circular polarization was transmitted, there was no shift of the polarization orientation angle. And in the right circular and the left circular, both the polar, we derived the hybrid polarimetric data set, left circular and the right circular, from the fully polarimetric LOS pulsar data set. And we compared so that we found that there was no shift of polarization orientation angle in the CTLR mode, CTLR hybrid polarimetric mode. Now, again, this is the Chandrayaan 1 mini SAR data set. So Chandrayaan 1 was operated on S-band 12.6 centimeter to acquire the data set for the North Polar and the other location and the other region of the lunar surface. So the Stokes vectors were derived by the RH and RV combinations of the SAR data set. And finally, for the partially polarized electromagnetic wave, this is the criteria, S naught square will be greater than S1 square plus S2 square plus S3 square. It means that the sum of square of the first scattering element will be greater than the sum of the squares of the remaining scattering elements. Now, when because when the data set will be fully polarimetric, then these decomposition modeling approaches, which were derived for Stokes parameter based decomposition modeling, could not be used because this the factor 1 minus m will become 0, because for the fully polarimetric SAR data set, m should be equal to 1. Degree of polarization will be equal to 1. So finally, this total amount will become 0. So we are not going to get any volume scattering information in the when we are using this decomposition, like hybrid polarimetric decomposition model, in the fully polarimetric SAR data set. So here, there is one decomposition model, Stokes vector-based modeling approach, and these elements which are derived like M and delta, these are known as the Stokes child parameter, derived from the Stokes parameter. So with the help of like the first element is going to give you the odd bounce scattering information, the second element is going to give you the volume scattering information, and this is going to give you the double bounce scattering information. Now, when you are talking about the degree of polarization M, so here you can see S2, this is equal to the square root of S2 square plus S3 square plus S4 square divided by 1. Now you can think, when S1 square will be equals to S2 square plus S3 square plus S4 square, then M will become 1. In the case of fully polarimetric data set, then these decomposition models could not be used. Okay. Now there are other Stokes child parameter, like degree of depolarization, degree of circular polarization ratio, CPR, relative phase. So these are used in the decomposition modeling. There are M delta, M chi, and now M alpha, because this was the H alpha decomposition used by one of the researcher in IRS. She used the H alpha decomposition to do the decomposition modeling for the Erlanger crater of the lunar surface. So first she implemented M delta, then M chi, then these are the CPR values. So what was the main finding? Like the scattering of the, like this is the crater, impact crater. So the scattering retrieved from the center of the crater is entirely different than the surface. Like scattering in this case, what we are getting, surface of the lunar surface is showing outside of the crater, it is showing the dominance of surface scattering, but inside of the crater, it is showing the dominance of the volume scattering. It means that the material which is present inside of the crater is completely different than the outside of the crater. So that there are several regions. So one of the famous region after doing the CPR analysis and this scattering analysis was the due to the presence of water ice in the lunar regolith or at the center of the crater, so that it might be possible to get volume scattering information, like in the case of, but there are several other facts, but I think after launch of Chandrayaan 2 with the help of dual frequency fully polarimetric SAR data set, we will have a strong proof to identify the presence of water ice in the lunar regolith. Like with the help of hybrid polarimetric SAR data set, one can do the pseudo quad pole generation from the hybrid polarimetric SAR data set. Like this is the hybrid polarimetric SAR data set for Dhoon Valley. This is the river Ganga, and surface scattering, volume scattering, and double bounce scattering elements were derived from the data set. And finally, this is the color composite image generated from the hybrid polarimetric SAR data set after generating the pseudo quad pole. And during pseudo quad pole, this data set was also hybrid polarimetrically calibrated, so that one can easily see that this riverbed, dry riverbed, we are getting surface scattering from the sand, and water is showing your like complete specular reflection, so that it is appearing as very dark feature. And from the urban area, we are going to get the double bouncy scattering, which is represented here in the red color. And for the forest, we are again going to get the presence of different type of scattering, mostly volume scattering. But due to the stem-ground interaction, stem-ground interaction through canopy gaps, we are getting the double bouncy scattering as well as surface scattering also. Thank you.